Was supposed to be localism week. It's ended up being a weekend and a week overshadowed by a new set of sex claims going right back to the 60s. It's been some pretty bizarre chain of events. Isabel, what's happening? What's going on?
So over the weekend, the row over this missing dossier that was passed to the Home Office has grown.
Dossier into what?
Dossier into child abuse claims. So this was passed to the Home Office but then disappeared and can now not be found. So Theresa May is going to give a statement today setting out not just the QC who's going to be investigating this particular dossier, where it's gone, why it's disappeared, but also the wider government response to the child abuse row, to the suggestion that there was a paedophiling operating in Westminster.
And the dossier, the centre of the investigation is what?
It contains allegations about child abuse, but...
Child abuse carried out by...
By politicians, allegedly.
This is a file that was passed in the 1980s. No one can now...
Into activity which happened in the 80s or the 70s?
Involving people who were active in public life in the 80s. But I mean, the question here is this, is they can't find the file. Now, I don't think that's necessarily proof of any great conspiracy, although obviously fans of fames of those people who do see some massive cover-up going on here. Because, I mean, if you look at the complete shambles at the passport office, you know, the idea of bureaucracy losing files, being unable to find things, doesn't necessarily prove wrongdoing. But I think what's happened is there's been such a complete collapse in trust with paedophile priests, Jimmy Savile, Rolf Harris, that now all of these things are almost taken as true until proven to be false. And this is the problem that the government has got itself into, is in trying to prove that there isn't anything going on. Whenever you say there's nothing going on, people say, oh, that's a cover-up. And so we're in this kind of vicious circle where it's almost impossible for politicians to kind of calm this kind of public concern. And I think what's going on is people are saying, well, if it happened in the church, if it happened in the BBC, if it happened in the NHS, you know, what's the last institution left? I mean, it's Westminster, it's politics.
Is this party political? Are we effectively talking about Tories here? I mean, I'm struck that the sort of chief protagonist here is Tom Watson, you know, a very active Labour campaign guy. If he is the one throwing stones, you've got to wonder.
I don't think it is just Tories. I mean, the front page of Daily Mirror today has an allegation about a former minister in the Blair government. And then one of the Sunday papers had an accusation.
Mayo had a Labour peer.
A Labour peer. I don't think this is party political. And I think one of the things that the leaderships, all three parties, are aware of is that no one wants to be accusing the other parties of some kind of complicity or involvement in this, because they might well have similar problems. I don't think it's inherently party political.
I think the party political element is also about Cooper writing to Theresa May, accusing her of a lack of leadership and calling for the Home Office to respond to calls that Yvette Cooper apparently made a year or so ago for a wider investigation into child abuse. So Labour are trying to sort of snap at the Tories' heels politically on this issue, but not on the child abuse allegations so much as the government's response.
People say that they want these people brought to justice, yet they're also saying that they want a public inquiry. Well, you can't have a public inquiry and a police inquiry at the same time. There's also lots of pressure online and on Twitter and places for people to name the people involved, you know, use parliamentary privilege to stand up and say who's been accused. Well, if those people are still living, once someone has stand up and used parliamentary privilege to name them, it's clearly impossible for them to get a fair trial, and that means that they will never be tried and if found guilty, convicted of these offences. I think we are... Child abuse is the most horrific thing imaginable. But we need to avoid turning into Salem, kind of everyone rushing to conclusion. I think we desperately need a bit of calm right now. I think the other thing I would say here, which everyone should be very aware of, is just remember the McAlpine affair. You know, that was an example of an allegation got going, people named someone involved on Twitter,
and journalists, or rather the Bureau of Investigative Journalism, which isn't quite the same thing, but got very excited. And then we ended.
And it turned out not to be true. It ended up in a situation where the Director General of the BBC had to resign. Sally Berko has had to pay libel damages. I think I'm right in saying that. So let's everyone just take a deep breath and let's get to the bottom of this. But let's not do it in a way that is reminiscent of Salem.
Well, what Ed Miliband had hoped to talk to about today was about his new localism policy. He's written a piece in The Guardian. And it jumped out to me, James, because this was language that Blair could have been using. He's saying we're going to devolve, we believe, we don't like top-down instruction, we believe in people power. So is he rowing back to the sort of Blairite agenda which he's so
not
vigorously astute?
I mean, there's several things going on here, which is this localism agenda is one of the kind of fault lines in the Labour Party between the kind of the John Cruddas radicals and the Spencer Livermore electoral pragmatists.
What do they believe?
So Cruddas believes that he wants everything sent locally. And that you need services that are closer to people if they're going to be more responsive, mm-hmm. if there's going to be more kind of democratic accountability. Now, previously, the Treasury hadn't liked this idea at all. But Ed Balls is a surprising convert to it, because I think he's realised that, A, this ticks a kind of radicalism box without spending money, and B, it probably enables him to save money, in that it means someone else will have to do some of the cuts. Some of these town halls that have been given responsibility will have to do some of the things. The extent to which this is not a Blairite reform is it's very noticeable that Miliband is... David Miliband used to talk about double devolution. Mm-hmm. So devolution both to individuals and to town halls. This is very much single-shot devolution. It is just of the town halls.
So Isabel, we're talking about transferring power from one bureaucracy to another, Westminster to... But is there an expectation, you think, that the people of Leeds and Manchester are going to reward them with votes? Because all the politicians now are talking about this. It seems to be the vogue subject.
Yes, it is. I think it's the idea that voters are fed up of feeling powerless and that someone somewhere far away is taking a decision on their behalf without really taking into account mm-hmm. what they want. I think also, if you look at impressive local authorities in cities that have grown like Manchester, mm-hmm. they're really ambitious councils that have been trying to persuade central government to give them more powers for years. And politicians like Hilary Benn, John Cruddas, who've been working on this in Labour, have looked at Manchester and thought, well, why can't we do what's happened in Manchester for Stoke and give them more power?
Sure, but you can look at Birmingham, where they've got lots of power, the most, you know, and it's been a complete disaster. I mean, yeah. Manchester is an example of good local government. Birmingham's a disaster, an example of very bad, disastrous local government.
And if you talk to people in the Tories and Labour privately, one of the fears they do have is that because the centre has taken so much away from local government over the past few decades, the quality of person working in local government is not as good as it could be. Now, it's not mm-hmm. to offend very hard-working, ambitious councillors, but if you're very ambitious and very impressive, you may head for the centre rather than staying in your town or your city, which means that there's a dearth of talent in some local authorities to be able to take on these powers. But you can't make an omelette without breaking eggs, and if you're going to hand over those powers, you instantly make local government much more attractive, because you're not just making decisions about bins and things that people who are ambitious might think are boring. Yeah.